In this section, we will look at another example of costs that are initially capitalized as assets and then expensed when the assets are used by the firm. Fixed assets comprise things like buildings, machinery, and equipment that firms buy and use over many years. Depreciation is the process by which the cost of these long-term assets is expensed to the income statement. When fixed assets are purchased, there are often material associated costs in addition to the purchase price that must be paid in order to get the assets delivered, installed, and ready for use in the business. Accounting rules require that all costs that are necessary to purchase and get the asset ready for use be capitalized as part of the cost of the asset. The associated costs can include things like freight or transportation costs, installation costs, and the cost of test runs if necessary. Let's look at an example to make sure you understand first what I mean by capitalization, and second, to see how depreciation expense is recorded. In this example, assume the firm buys machinery with a purchase price of $5,000 and pays another $1,000 to have the machinery installed and set up for use in its production plant. Clearly, the purchase price will be capitalized and recorded as an asset, as we've seen in previous examples. Cash decreases by $5,000, and machinery increases by $5,000. The question really centers around how to handle the $1,000 of installation costs. One possibility would be to expense that $1,000 by recording it as you see here, with a $1,000 decrease to cash and a $1,000 expense on the income statement. However, the thinking is that this cost is more properly thought of as really part of the acquisition cost of the asset. The machinery won't do you any good if it's not properly installed and set up, so those costs are just as integral to buying the machine as the purchase price. Under that logic, the accounting rules require that the installation costs also be capitalized, which means that rather than showing the $1,000 as an expense that immediately reduces net income and retained earnings, instead capitalize the $1,000 by adding it to the machinery account. The result is the machinery is recorded at a total cost of $6,000, which is the amount that will be depreciated in future periods. To summarize, capitalization will add more cost to the assets while at the same time showing less expense on the current period's income statement. However, whatever amounts are capitalized will eventually be expensed as the firm depreciates its assets, which is what I want to turn to now. As I said earlier, depreciation is an accounting process whereby the total cost of an asset is allocated to the income statements of the periods in which the firm uses the assets to make sales and generate revenues. This is just another illustration of the accrual method in action for expenses. Just as the accrual method required revenues to be recognized when they are earned, not necessarily when the cash is received, so too with expenses. They should be recognized when they're incurred or used to generate the revenues recognized during the period. In this way, expenses are matched with the revenues they help to generate. When the firm buys machinery, it's not yet used in the business, so all the costs are capitalized and no expenses shown. But then, as the firm puts the machinery in use and begins producing and selling its products, it should start to expense the asset through depreciation. Various methods for computing depreciation expense are allowed under both U.S. GAAP and IFRS. We will only look at the most common approach, straight-line depreciation. Depreciation expense is computed under the straight-line method by subtracting the residual value from the cost and dividing that amount by the estimated useful life of the asset. Residual value is an estimate of what the asset will be worth at the end of its useful life. Both the residual value and useful life must be estimated by management based on how they intend to use the asset in their business. In our example, we will assume that $6,000 has been capitalized as the total cost of the machinery and that the firm estimates a useful life of 10 years, at which time the machinery will only have scrap value, which is estimated to be zero. Depreciation is then calculated as $6,000 divided by 10 years, or $600 per year. This is recorded as an expense on the income statement, reducing net income and retained earnings, and as a decrease to the machinery account, since the firm has used up 1/10 of the asset. Notice that in this example, I've shown the decrease to machinery by directly decreasing the machinery account by $600. A more common approach to recording the decrease in machinery is to use a separate valuation account called accumulated depreciation. The only difference here is that rather than subtracting the $600 of depreciation from the machinery account, the depreciation is put into an accumulated depreciation account that is always presented as a subtraction from the machinery account on the balance sheet. This is why we refer to it as a valuation account, since it's used to properly value the machinery at its cost minus any depreciation taken. Investors and analysts prefer this disclosure because it provides some insight into how much of the asset has been used by comparing the amount in accumulated depreciation with the original cost, both of which are displayed in this presentation. Key takeaways are that depreciation is not an attempt to show the market value of the asset. It is not intended to represent the decrease in the market value of the asset, but rather, it is simply a cost allocation process to record the cost of an asset as an expense as it is being used by the firm. Depreciation does not use any cash. The cash has already been spent when purchasing the asset. So even though depreciation is an expense on the income statement and reduces net income, it does not use up any cash, which is why we often refer to it as a non-cash expense. Finally, lots of management estimation goes into calculating depreciation expense. Investors rely on the auditor to double-check management's assumptions to ensure they are reasonable and consistent with how the firm actually uses the assets in practice. If it appears that management is using unrealistic assumptions, then the auditor should require that management use better and more realistic assumptions.